so it's always gonna like.
And you decide.
Right.
What we're trying to play is some card.
I just spoke it up.
So it's everything below it.
It's probably got like. So I was like, so I have this. I'm not going to show up on that. Tell the bomb that that's my house. Come and tell me ready.
I asked you to question.
There is a homework on Canvas, homework 2. It's online. It's about online learning and the Perceptron algorithm. Particularly, it's asking you to invent a mistake bound algorithm for a certain kind of a concept and analyze a variant of the halving algorithm. So, has anyone started? And any questions? Yeah.
Question number 2, it's called a mistake bound algorithm.
Right.
But I thought that by definition that had to be memory mistakes in relation to the dimension of the input, and this has nothing to do with
that. Is right. This is, it should have really been called online learning. The section title is you're right. In fact, I never thought about that. That said though, there is the second part of question 2 is about the halving algorithm.
Yes.
And if you think about it, the halving algorithm basically gives you the best possible mistake bound on finite concept classes. So I'm not going to say too much, but you might be able to, the algorithm that you invent for the first question, you might end up with an optimal strategy. I have to think about whether it is a mistake bound or not, because the dimensionality is tricky.
Yeah, I mean, so we have two inputs, so technically it's dimension two, but these inputs can take on.
Yeah, but still, it is two. That's right. But you still call it two-dimensional.
Right.
That's right, you're right. It is two-dimensional, but there are many discrete values that they can take. There's a constraint. The definition of the input space says inputs can only lie on integer points in the on the plane. So there are only a finite number of functions. And then the question is, what is the fastest way to search this subset of functions? And you might end up with an algorithm that might essentially be doing the fastest thing possible.
So the algorithm we met cannot be having algorithm or anything like that. It has to be one of our own creation.
You can't just write, we will use the Hamming algorithm here.
If we describe the Hamming algorithm, does that work?
Just follow the steps. I mean, go ahead.
I mean, if you follow the steps, you could like just do the Hamming algorithm in the steps. As long as you have the steps.
You'll get something similar, but we specifically for this question, we're looking for detailed answers that are directly tied to that, rather than saying, oh, we will do this abstract thing that the Hamming algorithm does.
Right.
So maybe you can try to instantiate the Hamming algorithm here. Using the specific setting that is described. But that should, I don't want to say too much, because what you have is a close, is a reasonably good strategy to think about the answer. A hint here is, think about what the Hamming algorithm does. At any point, you have this set of functions and you drop off more than half. So those of you who have recently or not so recently taken some sort of an algorithms class, what other algorithm does that?
Binary search.
So there's your hint. Think binary search when you are coming up with the algorithm. Okay, any questions? Other questions? I think I have more announcements, so any final thoughts about the homework? As always, there's a good discussion on Canvas. Please continue that. It'll be useful for you to keep an eye on what other people are saying, and also the feedback that they get for their questions. There was a project milestone last week. Almost all of you have chosen to do either the exploratory or the other kind of project, the competitive project. I say almost all. There's a small subset of you who forgot to answer. We'll be contacting you. So the next thing to on the project timeline is there's a milestone on 28th of September. And if you're doing an exploratory project, you have to submit a project proposal. And the project proposal, you should please do it only once a team, so that we don't so that the grading and stuff becomes easy. All you have to say in the project proposal is who is in your group, just to confirm what you'll be working on. Describe the project that you want to work on, and talk about why it's interesting and why it's relevant to the class. The way it will work is, after everything is done, I'll read the project proposals, I'll read them, and decide whether this seems like, you'll get essentially a go-no-go decision, and maybe some pointers for here are some things that you can try. So the kind of project proposals that I will turn down are if the entire project seems to be dependent on some data that will be collected in the future. So if the data set is not there, I'm not going to allow the project, if this is a project that involves an experiment. And in that case, I'll just move you to the competitive side. another kind of a project that is that I will not allow is if it seems too big. So for an example is today is September 19th. By December 15th, I'm going to solve natural language processing. I like the optimism, but it's not going to happen. So those and if it is too big, I will automatically assume that you didn't spend too much time thinking about the scope of the project, and I'll move you to the competitive side. So really, you have to put some effort to stay in the exploratory side of the project. If you are doing the competitive project, we will be giving you, if you've chosen to do that, we'll be giving you information, or we'll be setting up a Kaggle in class. We'll be sharing login information with you. By the 28th, you should have registered and at least made one dummy submission. We'll give you information about what this means. You should have made one dummy submission that essentially gets you the baseline numbers. This should happen by the 28th. Any questions?
When can we look for those login details?
So I will be by this weekend. So we're just setting it up and pre-processing the data and such things. Oh, so the task will be Twitter spam bot detection. All right, any other questions about projects? And if you have any thoughts about, I have this idea, I want to work on it, but I don't know if I should continue with this or move on, you're welcome to come talk to me or send me an email. I tend to be much, much slower with email, as some of you might have noticed. So you might want to talk to me or send a message on Canvas. The other thing is, some of you were also looking for project partners on Canvas. I hope that got ready. All right, any other thoughts or questions about projects or homeworks? Yes?
If I choose a comparative project, can I also do the project that I'm interested in, not the one you have
to do? No, I mean, who do you compete with? If you want to do your own project, you are in the other group. You can let me know. All right. So if there are no questions, let's move on to the lecture for today. Today we're going to look at one of the oldest algorithms that were called caught the public attention in this machine learning space. It's a Perceptron algorithm. It's an online algorithm, and the agenda for this unit is we look at the algorithm itself, and after that I'll show you how the Perceptron algorithm is a mistake-bound algorithm if it is played in this online setting, and this is one of those nice proofs that actually small enough to fit in one or two slides, so we'll see the entire proof. And after that, we'll look at a bunch of variants of the Perceptron algorithm which are actually used rather than the vanilla version of the algorithm, and we'll look at these variants and talk about it. So just a heads up, you'll be implementing multiple variants of the Perceptron algorithm for your homework. So let's start with the Perceptron algorithm itself. So the setting is something that we've seen before. The inputs are n-dimensional vectors, essentially n features, n real value features. And the output is a bit, either true plus 1 or false minus 1. Just to remember that a linear threshold unit is a classification machine that takes an example of this form and follows this decision rule. Has inside it something called a weight vector, just a set of parameters, and a bias. When a new input comes in, it takes a dot product of the weights with the input, so W transpose X, adds the bias, you get a number, and looks at the sign of that number. And the output is the sign of the number. If the sign is positive, the output is true. If the sign is negative, the output is false. Or if you don't like to see the sine function, it's essentially this. If, I guess my pen is dead. If W transpose X plus B is greater than 0, then the output is plus. If W transpose X plus B is less than 0, then the output is minus. And we've seen this before, and we'll be seeing a lot of this, so you should get comfortable with this sort of thinking. Another way you might see this, I mean, not as ugly pictures as this, but often conceptually, you might see it written this way. You have 8 inputs here. See if this works again. Okay, x1, x2, all the way to x8. And there is a constant input that's called the bias feature. And these inputs are fed through wires to a unit that adds up. That's the unit at the top here, the summation. And as the input feature travels along the wires, it gets multiplied by the weight. So the x1 gets multiplied by w1, and so on. At the summation unit, you have w1 x1 plus w2 x2 plus and so on plus the last one, b. And then this number gets passed on to a threshold unit, which looks at a number and says, is it positive or negative? And the sign of that thing is the output. The reason that I've drawn it this way is this is like essentially how some people think of neural networks. Right? You have some units that are called neurons, and the wires are associated with weights, and information gets passed along the wires. This has a nice geometric intuition as well. Since we are talking about linear classifiers, any point, the input is any point in this n-dimensional space. Here, the two-dimensional space. The linear threshold unit slices this space into two parts. And when a new point comes in, you check whether this point lies on one side or the other, and you call one side positive and the other side negative. So there is a nice geometric interpretation as well, and we'll be looking at this kind of a geometric interpretation to understand what the perceptron algorithm does. So the perceptron algorithm is really old. The paper that introduced the algorithm is from 1958. The inventor of this algorithm is Franz Rosenblatt, and it was a probabilistic model for storage and organization inside the brain. I'm not sure it's entirely accurate, but that's what it was advertised as. And this is also an interesting thing to note, that this came out in 1950. This algorithm was published in 1958 and was immediately followed by a media onslaught. The New York Times said, there's a new Navy device that learns by doing. And if you can't read the bottom, it says, the service, the Navy, said it would use the principle of, it expects that this computer will be able to talk, walk, see, reproduce itself, and be conscious of its existence. It's expected that this, all of this will be done in about a year at the cost of $100,000. 1958, that was July. The New Yorker said, the perceptron is capable of what amounts to original thought. The first perceptron is yet to be built, but you know, if you believe the New York Times, it was ready to be done in a year. So 1959, we had a machine that could walk, talk, reproduce, and have conscious thought. This was one of, at least to my knowledge, the first instance of a neural network hype, where the media is in a frenzy about what neural networks can do. We are in the middle of one, so it's good to know such things happen. Just also another thing that I want to point out, the budget for this perceptron algorithm was $100,000 in 1958. It required Navy investment, you know, the government investment. Just as a sign of how far things have come, you'll be doing this in your homework. So we don't need $100,000, you'll be doing it for about, I don't know, 50 points. Also, you'll be doing it on machines that are much, much better than this one here. This was the IBM 704 computer on which the first perceptron algorithm was supposedly implemented. And if you don't recognize it as a computer, it's this thing between the people. And this was before transistors were invented. This was before anything that we think of as a computer today was in existence. Today, this is a computer. And again, the point is, if you think your homework is hard, try programming it in that thing. All right, so fun aside, the point is, the Perceptron algorithm is so simple, it could have been implemented inside a device that was so simple. So, just a summary of this history, the algorithm was came first introduced in a paper by Rosenblatt in 1958, and simply the goal, I mean, I don't know if Rosenblatt actually introduced it in this fashion, but the goal of this algorithm is to find this separating higher plane. You have a collection of points, some of them are positive, some of them are negative, and the goal is to find this line or plane that separates these two. And the cool thing about this algorithm, and we'll be looking at this in a while, the cool thing about this algorithm is that if there exists a plane that separates the data, then this algorithm is guaranteed to find it, making only a small number of mistakes. It's an online algorithm. Remember, we saw online algorithms in the last couple of lectures. It processes one example at a time. At any point, it sees an example, the example comes in, it makes a prediction. And if the prediction is, if it is not happy with the prediction defined in a certain way, then it will correct itself and throw away that example. But that's the online version of the algorithm. There are many, many variants of this the Perceptron algorithm, and we'll be looking at them towards the end of this unit, but really most of the time when people use the Perceptron algorithm today, they don't use it in an online setting because what we end up doing is we have a fixed set of examples called the training set. We can't mimic this idea of an infinite stream of examples coming in, so what we do is we keep shuffling the training set and running the Perceptron update over that fixed set again and again. And this idea of using a fixed training set to simulate this online thing is called an online to batch conversion. The batch version of the Perceptron is what you'll be implementing, and that's the version of the Perceptron that essentially most people use when they say they use the Perceptron algorithm. The entire algorithm is so simple that I can fit it in four lines. So the input to this algorithm is a sequence. It's a sequence of examples, x1, x2, xi, labeled with a bit, true or false. We'll call them y1, y2, and so on. So xi's can be any vectors in this n-dimensional space, and yi's are -1 or 1. The simplest version of this algorithm, and the one that we'll actually analyze, does the following. Remember that the algorithm is required at the end to produce a weight vector, a linear threshold as a unit. A linear threshold unit is completely defined by the weights. So what the algorithm maintains is this weight vector. It initializes the weights with the zero vector, we'll call that w0. And now the game starts. An example comes in. So let's see if the pen works this time. Look. So an example comes in, and let's call this xi, and it has a label yi. Before even looking at the label, the Perceptron learning algorithm first makes a prediction. How do you make a prediction? It's a linear threshold unit. It has a current weight vector, so it makes a prediction by taking the dot product of Wt, the current weight vector, Wt, and xi. It multiplies these two things and looks at the sign. Makes a prediction, let's call the prediction y prime right there. And now, one of two things can happen. Either the prediction is correct, in which case you don't do anything, or you made a mistake. Y prime is the predicted label is not equal to yi. In which case the update is rather simple. You need to update the wt to produce the wt plus 1. This update is called the Perceptron update. What you do is you take the old weights and you add a scaled version of the example to the weights. How do you scale it? You multiply the example with yi. And there's an R here. R is like a learning rate. We can worry about that later. But essentially, you take the example, you multiply it with the label, and you add it to the weights. And you scale that by a learning rate. You do this till you are happy or you run out of examples, and you return the final weight vector. Just a few things to note. The prediction here is the sign of W transpose X. Always, you should keep in mind that there is a bias term, W transpose X plus B, because if you do not have a bias term, then you are restricting these classifiers to be only lines that go through the origin. If B is always 0, you only get lines that go through the origin. So there is always a bias feature, bias term, but if you remember when we spoke about linear threshold units, there was this trick that pushed the bias feature into one of the bias term into the weight vector by introducing this one additional feature, the constant feature. And so we'll assume that there's always a constant feature, and we'll not worry about keeping this bias thing around. But you should always remember to check if your data set has a bias feature. Now, I'm not entirely sure if the data that you have for your homework has a bias feature. So if it does not, then you need to add a constant bias feature or have an explicit or an implicit bias weight. Yes?
So the vector...
Can you speak up?
The vector we're going to be as Rn plus 1?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. It's Rn plus 1, or if you assume that the xi's come with a constant, it's that nth feature is always 1.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, one way or one. Any questions about that? Yeah?
Can you please give an example?
Can you speak up?
Can you please provide an example of how...
How the entire algorithm. I'll be giving you an example. Yes. All right. By the way, this is something I mentioned before, but it's good to remind you. Essentially, a binary classifier predicts true or false. Sometimes, we'll be referring to false using or denoting false using the number -1. Sometimes, 0. So, when we were talking about Boolean functions, we use zeros and ones. Here, it's more convenient to represent false as -1 because the math just looks a little simpler. True is always 1. Alright, so let's kind of tease this algorithm apart first before looking at an example. Now, there are two kinds of mistakes that can happen. It's kind of annoying. Give me a minute, I'm going to charge this thing while we are... There are two kinds of mistakes that can happen. You can have a mistake on a positive example or a negative example. You can have a mistake on a positive example, that means the true label is plus, but the predicted label is minus. If you have a mistake on the negative example, that means the true label is minus, but the predicted label is plus. In both cases, the algorithm needs to correct itself. So what we'll do now is tease apart that one-line update rule and look at what happens if the true label is positive and there's a mistake, and what happens if the true label is negative and there's a mistake. And if you're lucky, you've got enough charge. Maybe that was not the brightest thing to do. Yeah, okay. Cool. So, this update here, let's split it into two parts. If there's a mistake on a positive, notice that this yi, in this case, yi equals plus 1. When yi is plus 1, it disappears. You're just saying, I take the feature vector xi, and add it to the weight with a scaled thing. So, wt plus xi. Right? So, essentially, the weight vector, if you add the xi to wt, it will start looking more like xi, right? So you want the weight vector to look like a positive example. Similarly, if in this case, mistake on negative means yi is -1. When yi is -1, this update really means you take the original weight vector and you subtract xi from it. Which means you made a mistake on a negative example, meaning you predicted it as positive, and you want to take away the example from the weight. Essentially, the goal here is you want your weight vector in the long run to look more and more like the prototypical positive example. Because you keep adding positive examples and you keep subtracting negative examples. We'll look at this in a bit. We'll look at a pictorial version of the same argument. The learning rate is just a small number. Think of it as a small positive number less than 1. There will be some, as always, there will be useful tricks with the learning rate. We'll see that later. This is a mistake-driven algorithm. An update happens if and only if there's an error. If there's no error, you don't make updates. Question.
Do we update the weight right then, or do we wait until we've gone seen every example?
This is an online algorithm. You make an update immediately.
Okay.
So this is inside the loop.
Okay.
And by the way, this is the simplest version. There are so many variants. This algorithm is older than I guarantee everyone in this room. So, of course, there are many, many variants. We'll see some of the more robust variants as we go along. Here I've written mistake as with two steps. First, I make a prediction, and then I check if it's equal to the ground truth. I could have rewritten mistake as this quantity here. Can anyone tell me why this is the same as this one line is the same as those two lines?
Y is either plus 1 or minus 1.
That's right. So then what happens? Can we do the case analysis here? So, or I'll do the case analysis. So y prime, the prediction is the sine of w transpose x. And I want to check mistake if y prime not equal to yi.
If the signs are always going to be opposite, so you're always going to have a negative number if it's a mistake.
That's exactly right. The intuition is if y prime is not equal to yi, it can happen in only one of two cases. Y prime equals plus 1 and yi equals minus 1, or y prime equals minus 1 plus 1. The signs are opposite. But what does it mean that when y prime is plus 1? It means that the sign w transpose x is greater than or equal to 0. When this is the case, this means w transpose x is less than 0. So let's compare these two with this thing here. In both cases, I multiply w transpose x with yi. What's the value of yi times w transpose x in this case? It's less than 0. Right? Because w transpose x is positive, yi is negative, so that's negative. Similarly, we can multiply these two quantities, yi, w transpose x is again less than 0 because yi is positive and w transpose x is negative. So, I can, instead of doing these two steps, I can always say, mistake if yi, w transpose x is less than 0. Essentially, if you look at the sign, if yi w transpose x is less than 0, then you know that there's been a mistake. And almost always, we'll be using this rather than splitting it into two steps, because this has some interesting geometric interpretations that become useful as we go along. Any questions? Yes?
So, if it equals 0.
Oh, if it's equal to 0, we'll assume there's a mistake. Just let me make it equal.
It can be a mistake or not mistake.
Yeah, so we'll assume it's a mistake so that it triggers an update. Because if it's equal to 0, it's just to be safe, let's make it call it a mistake so that we may get an update. So that learning changes. I thought there was another hand. Yeah. Oh. I haven't told you why. I've only told you what. We'll talk about the why in a bit. So far, all I have said is this is what happens in the algorithm. I've told you no. I've given you no reason to believe that this is a meaningful thing to do. Yes.
Is this handling the bias? Or is that
the bias is folded into the weight? So, in fact, that's a now that I have my pen, I can actually write this up. The true thing, the really what we want to do is W transpose X plus B and take its sign. Right? But W is simply W1, W2, it's a vector, this is W transpose. And X is X1, X2, Xn, it's an n-dimensional vector plus B. What I suggested was we introduce this one new feature called the bias feature and put B into the weight. So this is equal to, sum over Wi I plus B, but I can also write this as equal to W1, Wn. Let's say I put the B at the end, times X1, Xn, and the number 1. This is also equal to sum of Wi I plus B. I can always assume the weights have a particular weight that we have designated as the bias weight if there's always a certain feature that is constant and equal to 1. So I only need to think about, let's call this quantity W bar and let's call this new quantity X bar. So this is W bar transpose X bar. So this representation allows for the existence of a bias feature. Yeah.
So to be clear, on our homework, when we pull it in, we're going to add another dimension.
I think so. You have to check. So the first thing that you should do when you look at the data, is there a feature that seems to be constant and available in every example?
Really?
If there is, that's the bias feature.
That's kind of a big assumption to make.
No, you check it in the data, in the training set. I think in your data it's not true, and in fact, to be safe, what I can tell you what I do. In any new problem that I encounter, if I have to implement a learning algorithm, I don't care whether the data has a bias feature or not, I always add one. I always increase the dimensionality by 1. Let's say you have a bias feature in the data, I'll just add 1 more. And that will have another, let's call this a W0 here. Who cares? I mean, you're just adding one dimension, and you're just by adding one dimension, you're increasing the expressivity of your classifier, might as well get that. So a general word of advice, always, if you're implementing a learning algorithm, when you read the data, add a bias feature just so that you're safe. Yes?
It doesn't matter if the bias feature, if it already has the bias feature,
mm-hmm.
won't it then be...
it's superfluous, but it does not hurt. It does not necessarily help, but it certainly does not hurt.
How does it not hurt to have the bias times 2 in the result?
Sorry?
How does it not hurt to have the bias times 2 in the result?
Oh, because what will happen is, in the original weight, so that's a good question. What? Let's say that in the original setting, you did not have the W0, and you just had B. And so you run any learning algorithm, let's say Perceptron, and you get some value, let's say B equals 100. Now, setting number 2, you add an extra bias feature, so you get both W0 and B. What the learning algorithm will converge on is W0 is 50 and B is 50.
Yeah.
So they will add up to be 100. And that's a good sanity check, in fact, to see if your learning works. It'll almost be the same, it won't be exactly 50, it'll be like 49 and a half and 51 and a half. It'll essentially, think about what happens. They will, both W0 and B will always move together. They will either increase together or decrease together. Which means they will have the same value. And we have some luxury here in terms of the actual magnitude of the W's. We don't care about multiplying the entire vector by any positive number, because we only care about the sign. So we can scale things up and down, it doesn't matter, because we only care about the sign, and that we have a degree of freedom because of that. Yes?
If we're adding that bias thing, what do we default it to? Because
the bias feature or the bias weight?
So the bias weight?
Once you add the thing, this W bar, think of it as any weight vector. It doesn't matter, you default it to 0. In the beginning, you start off with nothing and then the learning fixes itself. Or you default it to some random initialization.
Okay. Oh, and I see, because in the X, it'll always be 1.
Yep.
So we don't have that.
Yep. And I think in your homework, when you're implementing the perceptron, I explicitly ask you to initialize the W's randomly. And if you want to think about it, I want you to think about why that might or might not be a good or a bad idea. Think about what it means to initialize randomly. Alright, so now let's talk about, enough discussion about the linear classifier itself, let's look at the output. So, if you made a mistake on a positive example, that means that the label y is plus 1 and w transpose x, I tend to call it the score for that example, w transpose x is the score for that example, the score is negative. So, let's say we make an update. So then, let's say r is 1, so we've made a mistake on a positive example, that means you need to say wt plus 1, I've written it up there, I'm just copying it, is wt, the previous weight vector which made a mistake and needs to be penalized, plus x. So that's what we have here. The new weight vector is wt plus 1, the previous weight plus x. Now, the thing to keep in mind is, essentially, we are trying to make the new weight vector after the update look a bit more like the example that we just made a mistake on. When I say look a bit more, I mean this quantity, the dot product of the weight and the example, what is the dot product? The dot product is a scaled version of a cosine. So you can think of this as wt plus 1 transpose x is the norm of wt plus 1 times the norm of x times the cosine of, let's call this theta. Theta is the angle between these two vectors, right? If this dot product gets bigger, that means these two vectors are facing in the same direction. When cosine theta is 1, that means they are facing in exactly the same direction. After the update, what happens is, we can measure the dot product of these two vectors, wt t plus 1 transpose x is, we just made an update, so it is the previous weight plus x, dot product with x, which is the previous dot product, plus x transpose x. So, the new dot product is the previous dot product plus x transpose x. So, x transpose x is like x square, it's always positive. That means, after an update, the dot product between the weights in that example increases. So essentially, the weight vector starts looking a bit more like the positive example that we just made a mistake on. Also, another way of thinking about it is, after making a mistake, what is the score assigned to this positive example? The score is this dot product, right? The score is what we look at the sign. We look at the sign of w transpose x. After update, the score is guaranteed to increase because, let me just erase some of these unnecessary boxes. This is the score before update, this is the score after update. We made a mistake, which means W transpose X before the update was negative. It was a positive example and we made a mistake, so this quantity was negative. So what we are doing is we are changing the weight so that the updated weight is bigger, so that this it is getting closer to being positive, or maybe it is actually being positive. Similarly, you can do a similar sort of a reasoning for negative examples also. Essentially, if you think about these weight vectors scoring examples, for positive examples, we want the score to be large and positive. And a mistake means it was not positive. So, the perceptron update is a meaningful thing, to answer the question that came up. The perceptron update is a meaningful thing because after an update, it increases the score for positive examples, and you can follow the same sort of argument, it decreases the score for negative examples. It makes the score for a negative example closer to being negative, or actually more negative. This is after an update. Questions? And by the way, what I've just presented here is not a proof. This is just sort of intuitive arguments that the algorithm is doing something meaningful. Yes?
So the x we are using for the new dot product is different than the previous.
It's the same. We are still sitting inside the object. So I'm asking, the question that I'm asking here is, we have given an example x comma y, and let's say that example is plus 1. The quantity that we are tracking is the score of that example, before and after the update. The dot product of weights with that example before the update was negative. And after the update, because we are adding this positive quantity to that dot product, we are making it more positive. So this is like an intuitive argument for why this is not an unreasonable thing to do. Yes?
I was going to say, so when you say more positive, that means that it can still be negative.
Oh, it could definitely. Okay. We are not guaranteed that we'll correct it immediately.
Got it.
In fact, that's a good point. So just to expand on that, I'm going to draw a number line. And this is W transpose X, just a quantity, you know, there's a number. And let's say 0 is the point of interest. If it, W, this side is always positive and this side is always negative. We, let's say we have a positive example. Originally, let's say WT transpose X was here. We have a positive example, but we've made a mistake. And now, after update, WT is, or WT plus 1 is WT plus X. The argument that I just made says that WT plus 1 transpose X is greater than WT plus X. Maybe it came here. This could be WT plus 1 transpose X. Maybe you've not corrected it, maybe you're still making a mistake, you've just moved it closer to 0. Could go from here to here, or alternatively, it could go from here to here. It could be, you know, you could have corrected it just by the fact that you were lucky. It depends on the learning rate. So the learning rate governs how far a step you take on this line. If the learning rate is big, you immediately correct it. But the problem is you might end up over-correcting it because there might be noise. So there's some value in keeping the learning rate small. If you're a graduate student, one of the questions that you'll be implementing is a variant of the perceptron algorithm that every time you make a mistake is always guaranteed to push this on this side of zero, on the correct side of zero. This is called the aggressive update. Every time you make a mistake, you aggressively correct it. Make sure that you got that previous example right. But you're not guaranteed in the vanilla version. Good questions, let's move on. Let's look at the geometry of this update. The nice thing about the perceptron algorithm is that we are learning linear threshold units, so we can also think about what happens to the weight vector, or the hyperplane, not the weight vector, the hyperplane that's defined by the weight, before and after the update. Now, I'm drawing this, I'm going to show you this proof by pictures of what happens, and this is only in two dimensions, only for building intuition. So let's say that we have an old weight vector, W old, that is pointing in this direction. The vector points in that direction means the line is perpendicular to it. And what this really means is that this particular weight vector predicts this entire region as positive, and the region below as negative. Let's say this is WT, this is the current weight vector. And now a new example comes in. This example is positive. This example is x. It's a point in this two-dimensional plane, and it has a label plus 1. Notice that this weight vector has made a mistake. W old transpose x is less than 0. One way of thinking about it is this angle is more than 90. And so we need to now trigger an update. So we've made a mistake on a positive example, let's see what an update does. So the update for a positive example is, you take the old weight vector, which is this line here, and you add yx. Y is positive, so essentially you add x. Let's assume the learning rate is 1. Yx in this case, if this was x, then this is also x. I just shifted that line, and now I can look at what vector addition does. It just after addition, this is the new vector. So essentially, what has happened is after updating, you have turned the hyperplane. You have rotated the hyperplane, and in this case, I have, because I get to pick how the you know, what the pictures look like immediately after the update, the example where we made a mistake is predicted correctly. Because now this side is predicted as positive and the other side is predicted as negative. So essentially, what the perceptron update does is it, every time it makes a mistake, it turns the hyperplane so that it points in a different direction. And if these rotations are, you know, done well, you will learn. There's no guarantee that I'm only showing you proof by pictures. There's no guarantee that this works. It just seems like a good thing to do. You can let's do the same thing once more for a negative example.
Just like before we go
yes.
Because it's positive, we included one. Never mind, sorry.
Yes, that's right. Let's do the same thing again for a negative example. Let's say the weight vector originally was pointing down, which means this region is predicted as positive. And let's say that old example comes in, but this time as a negative example. And this was a negative example, and the region below the line is predicted as positive, so clearly there's a mistake. Another way of thinking about it is this angle is less than 90. So the dot product is positive. Okay, so we have to trigger an update. We need to look at the same thing. W is old W plus YX. This time Y is negative. So YX is a vector that points in the opposite direction to W. To X. YX is negative, so this would be minus X. So this is equal to minus X. And now we want to add W, the blue line that's pointing down, and the red dotted line, and that takes you in this direction here. Essentially, what we have done is now rotated the weights so that the angle between this angle that was less than 90 increases. Questions? Yes.
Sorry, why was the weight vector perpendicular to the hyperplane?
Oh, but that's just the definition of the a line. So the definition of a line is defined by a direction and a plane that's perpendicular to that direction.
Okay.
So in general, so if you have a direction, let's say this pen points to the direction of the vector W.
Yeah.
This defines a hyperplane. In fact, this defines a family of hyperplanes that are perpendicular to it. So they look. I don't have a sheet of paper. So this defines a family of hyperplanes that look like this. But this is just a direction. So this hyperplane could be here or anywhere in this that is perpendicular to this. And actually fixing it to be a single hyperplane is decided by the bias. The bias decides whether it's this plane that's perpendicular or this plane or this plane or this plane. I have put all these lines go through the origin here in this picture. That means the bias is zero. There is no bias. That's because I am in this n plus 1 dimensional space where I don't have a bias. In the n dimensional space, this might be not going through the origin.
In those examples, the error has been fixed in those examples.
The error?
Yes. I mean, change that.
Oh, in this case, the error. Yes. In this case, after the update, the mistake is no longer there. But there's no guarantee. Maybe the step size was not so big. Maybe the step size was so small that it was just this line here. So actually, the update is W plus R Y X. If R is very small, you'll get a very small update, and after the update, you get this line, which is still predicting the negative. So the step size might be too small, and the error might not be fixed, or the step size might be so large that the next examples will you will end up becoming perpendicular to. It might be overfitting this example. Yes. Can you speak up?
When doing the update, YW is plus by a vector YX plus not the value.
Oh, but the x is the vector. What do you mean? The value of x is the vector.
Because when plotting the y-axis, is a vector has a
direction and a magnitude.
Yes, and y has the direction.
Oh, but I don't understand. What do you mean by?
Why not just plot the value, but not?
I can't add a vector and a number. So in this case, w would be a two-dimensional thing. Let's call this feature x1. So you'll have w1 and w2. X will also look like x1 and x2. I can only add this to that. I think the question that you are really asking is, why is the length of x not relevant? If you have an example x that is just very, very small versus very, very long. They're all, and it actually is implicitly there, because a large x that's very large will make a bigger update, will make a bigger change to w. An x that's very small, because you're adding this thing. You're taking both the sign and the magnitude. You're scaling the value of x by some learning rate r, like this here. But that's, I think I'm answering your question. I'm not entirely sure what your question is, so you can correct me if I'm off track.
The black vector is two-dimensional, and the first dimensional is x, and the second dimensional is minus
black. Oh, that's a mistake. Okay, that's a mistake in notation. My pen is dead again. So that's not two dimensions. That is a vector and a label.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, that's a mistake in notation. Yeah, this is a mistake. So it's really x is this, comma y is plus 1. So this is a pair x, comma y. Yeah, yes.
So in this algorithm, how do you determine the desired value of the learning rate? So that
you use cross validation. Cross validation is a, learning rate is a hyperparameter for this algorithm. You try out different learning rates. And typically, the way to try it out is you go in orders of magnitude. When you're, for cross validation, I need a set of things to try. So you try, say, r equals 1, r equals 0.1, 0.01, 0.001, and such things. Instead of r equals 1, 0.9, 0.8, 0.7. You go in the orders of magnitude, because usually it's the order of magnitude that makes a difference. So yes, for the vanilla version of the perceptron algorithm, the learning rate is a hyperparameter. So, now, just to summarize, the perceptron algorithm is, so far, just an algorithm. It's not a learning algorithm, because I've not told you whether it learns or not. I will prove that it has some learning, but it does do some learning. But one thing to keep in mind is the perceptron algorithm can only learn what it can represent. It's searching over the space of linear threshold units, which means it can only produce a linear threshold unit, right? Which is seems like a trivial point, but really what it means is that it can only find the correct classifier if your data was linearly separable. What happened was, historically, in 1969, Minsky and Papert wrote a book called Perceptrons, which was extremely influential. So remember all that hype that was around the perceptron algorithm, with the New York Times articles and all that? That lasted almost a decade. At this point, these two guys wrote a book, Perceptrons, which, among other things, it's actually a fantastic book, which goes into some rather innovative ways of analyzing the geometry of these things. But among other things, it said, look, the perceptron algorithm is nice, but it cannot learn parity functions, XOR. XOR functions cannot be learned because, if you remember from the discussion on linear threshold units, XOR is a function that says positive here, and negative here. I cannot draw a line that separates out pluses and minuses. So the book from Minsky and Papert pointed out what now is actually in hindsight, an obvious fact, parity functions cannot be learned by perceptron. And essentially, this killed off research in neural networks for a substantial amount of time after this book. This book is responsible for what is called the first AI winter. Or, you know, that's the story. I mean, of course, there are many things that were responsible for it, but this is a nice story to tell. Yes?
I thought you said that we could represent the XOR function, the Perry function, by increasing the dimension.
You can, but that's right. That's in hindsight, after this book came about.
Okay, so the perceptron algorithm also can actually.
If you increase the dimensionality.
Okay.
In the, so you should keep in mind that this particular book came about in an environment where there were wild conjectures being thrown around. The perceptron can learn anything without doing anything to the data. You just give it data, you throw it at this deep net, sorry, perceptron, and it learns something. And the book pointed out, you know, you can't just get learning for free. Some functions cannot be learned without doing more.
Okay.
So it cannot learn things that cannot be represented by the instance space. You might want to change the instance space, and that might change the learnability.
Okay.
But that actually comes with some problems, and we'll see that when we look at the proof. So what you need to know from this part of the class is you need to know the perceptron algorithm, the perceptron update, really well. I mean, you need to know it so well that, you know, like if you leave this class and you do not know what the perceptron update is, not if you leave at the end of the semester, I'll be personally offended. You need to understand the geometry of this update because it's rather simple, and you need to understand that it represents linear classifiers. Let's now move on to an analysis of this algorithm, the mistake bound analysis of this algorithm. Before getting to the math, I'm going to summarize two properties, two theorems that that give you a flavor of what we'll be looking at. The first one is called the perceptron convergence theorem. In without formal notation, essentially what this says is if there exists a weight vector that can separate the data, then the perceptron algorithm will converge to a weight vector that also separates the data after making a finite number of mistakes. That's called the convergence theorem. And then there's a parallel theorem called the cycling theorem, which says if the training set is not separable, then the learning algorithm will cycle through the same set of weights infinitely because they all keep making mistakes. The idea is that this cycling theorem is true when the learning rate is fixed. So essentially, these two theorems say if the data set is linearly separable, the perceptron algorithm will find a separator that classifies the data. If the data set is not linearly separable, you'll be stuck in an infinite loop of weight vectors that are not good. And they are the same set of weight vectors, you'll cycle through the same set of weights. And this is in the case of fixed data set. What I'm going to do is, we won't look at the cycling theorem in too much detail, but we will look at a proof of the perceptron convergence theorem, and in particular, we'll look at a proof that also gives us the mistake bound for this algorithm. In order to understand this, I'm going to introduce this concept of margin, which is an extremely important idea that keeps coming up, not just in perceptron, but also when we eventually move on to support vector machines and such things. Now, let's say that we have a hyperplane, this kind of a line, that separates the data. And we have this data set of positive and negative examples. Very, very simply put, the margin of this data set with respect to that particular hyperplane is the distance between the closest point and the hyperplane. So if you have another line that looks like this that separates the data, then the margin is this distance here. Okay? So that's the margin of this hyperplane here with respect to that entire data set. I can also ask, what is the margin of the data set? The margin of the data set is the maximum possible margin for any hyperplane. So there are many, many hyperplanes that separate this data, right? This is another line that separates the data that puts positives in this direction. The margin of this is just this tiny distance here. I can try out every possible hyperplane and find the one that has the highest margin. The margin of that hyperplane is called the margin of the entire data set. So, can you tell me why the idea of a margin is an interesting one? Now imagine, and I want you to think of two cases. Consider a data set where the margin is extremely small versus a data set where the margin is extremely large. Which one of them would be easier to learn? Why?
There's a greater number of functions or hyperplanes that could separate it, and so you just have to find one of them rather than finding a specific one.
That's an intuitively correct argument, but I want you to think about what you just said. So what, you're right, I don't want to pick on you, but I'm going to use what you just said to point out something.
Okay.
The answer was, there are a greater number of hyperplanes if the margin is large, which actually is completely a reasonable answer. But think about the number of hyperplanes. How many hyperplanes are there in any region? Infinite. So in both cases, it's infinite. But your reasoning is correct, but the word number is kind of misleading, but the intuition is right. Yes?
You can use a higher learning rate, so you can take more aggressive steps.
You can take more aggressive steps. You can make bigger jumps, and you'll be kind of safe. Think of margin as this margin of safety. How big of a change you can make without making a mistake, without accidentally overshooting on the wrong side. So the margin is an important complexity parameter that decides the difficulty of learning a data set. And we'll encounter margin in the proof for the perceptron algorithm, and then later on when we come to SVMs, SVMs are essentially called large margin classifiers, where we take this idea of a margin and try to make, find the hyperplane that has the largest margin explicitly. So this concept of margin, we'll be coming back to this again and again. For now, all I want you to know is that this margin is this gap associated between the gap between the positive and negative examples, divided by 2, essentially. The largest gap, you put a line in the middle, and you get a large margin. If the margin is, and the margin is always positive because it's just this distance. Now, the mistake bound theorem for the perceptron, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to state the theorem. Walk you through an intuitive explanation for it, and if we have time, we will finish the proof today. There are 15 minutes, so I'm being ambitious. So, or at least I'll start with the proof. This theorem is, the algorithm was, yes?
So, is there a concept of a margin if the data is not quite linearly separable?
No.
Because of noise?
No. So the margin is defined for a separable data set. For a data set that is not separable, you might have to think about which are the fewest number of points I can remove so that the data becomes separable. And then you think about the margin. Alright, so the algorithm came out and was invented in 1958 or published in 1958, and almost simultaneously Bloch and Novikov proved the mistake bound theorem for this algorithm. And the setting is, suppose you have a sequence of examples, x1, labeled with y1, x2 labeled with y2, and so on. And these examples, these examples, let's assume that they have the following property. Every a point, xi, is a vector, right? It's a vector in n-dimensional space, but it also has this property such that every point, the norm of that vector is less than some number r. And of course, all the labels are plus and minus 1. So first of all, I want you to think about this quantity, this property. What this really means is that in two dimensions, there is a circle with radius r, and every point lies within it. The distance of the point from the origin is less than r. So my question to you is this a big restriction? Is this like something strong? Why not?
You will always find an R big enough to...
Exactly. You have a collection of points, all you have to do is find a big circle that fits the thing. All you do is take the point that is farthest from the origin and call its distance R. And call, R is the distance of the farthest point. So you can always find a big sphere, in this case hypersphere, with some radius r that contains all the data, you have all of infinity to play with. Okay. So that we so far we've made no assumptions. Essentially, this is saying there is some data set, and R is just a way of saying that it's a way of describing the property of the data, how far away from the origin it could be. Now let's talk about the idea that the data set is linearly separable. In fact, we'll assume that there's a unit vector u, which means the norm of u is 1, and there's a margin gamma in R plus, yeah, so a positive number gamma, such that yi u transpose xi is always greater than gamma. What does this mean? U transpose xi times yi. So u transpose xi is the is like the score of that of the example xi, right? So when an example xi comes in, u transpose xi is what we use to check if this like the example is classified as positive or negative according to this thing. Now if yi is positive, then u transpose xi, let's consider the quantity yi times u transpose xi. If yi is positive, then u transpose xi is just u transpose xi, saying that u transpose xi greater than gamma. If yi is minus 1, this means minus u transpose xi is greater than gamma, which means u transpose xi is less than negative gamma. Gamma is a positive number. What this really means, every positive example will be given a score that's more than gamma. Every negative example will be given a score that's less than gamma, less than negative gamma. Gamma is positive, which means every example will get a score that is appropriate to its label. Either positive examples will get a positive score, negative examples will get a negative score, and the closest example, the one that's closest to the hyperplane, will get a score of gamma. Because this is the minimum score that any example, positive or negative example gets. What this really says is that this data set is separable with a unit vector with a margin gamma. So what we have now, we are making assumptions. The first statement is not has not made any assumptions. It just says we have a data set. The second statement says the data set is linearly separable. We don't know u. This is just a hypothetical u. There exists a u that separates the data into positive and negatives correctly. Then the statement of the theorem is, in such a situation, the perceptron algorithm will make no more than r square over gamma square mistakes on the training set. We'll prove this, but the intuitive version here. So let's just quickly do a recap of all the points here. The condition that all examples have a norm less than r is really not a condition. It's just you can always find r that is big enough to cover all examples. So that's not so much. That's not a problem. Then the statement that yi u transpose xi for all I, for every example, is greater than gamma is simply saying that the data is separable with a margin gamma. Gamma is a complexity parameter that defines how difficult is the data set. That defines the separability of the data set. If u being a unit vector is really not a big, is not a constraint, it seems like restricting u to be a unit vector seems like a constraint, but actually it turns out it's not. After we get through the proof, you're welcome to work through the proof and try to build a different theorem, a vaguely different theorem that proves a slightly different mistake bound that says the mistake bound is multiplied by the norm of u. So u being a unit vector is not a big deal. So essentially, the theorem says, suppose we have a binary classification data set with n dimensional inputs, and the data is linearly separable, then the perceptron algorithm will find a separating hyperplane after making only a finite number of mistakes. I still not proved that this is a mistake bound algorithm. Because, you know, for a mistake bound, this finite number should be polynomial in the dimensionality. But that's an easy thing to prove when we'll get to that eventually. So I want you to, you know, stare at this a bit and think about it. This is a completely unintuitive thing. If the data set is separable, after making these many R-square over gamma-square mistakes, it doesn't matter that we have more data, it doesn't matter we label more examples or not, it doesn't matter if the data set examples are presented in an adversarial fashion by an adversary, it's okay. After making R-square over gamma-square mistakes, we can declare that learning is done. That's a powerful statement. And this is even in the adversarial setting. It doesn't matter if the examples are presented by an adversary. The only condition, and this is the big condition, the only condition is that we require the data set to be separable, which we never know upfront. Because if I give you a new data set, like for example, the data set that you're using for your homework, what's the guarantee that it's separable? We don't know. The theorem says, if the data set is separable, then the perceptron algorithm is guaranteed to learn a classifier that separates the data. Any questions before we look at the proof?
I think I've is there some relationship between R and gamma? Because if not, we could scale our hypersphere arbitrarily and like improve on this bound.
Actually, the reason the bound has R is because of that relationship. Really, the bound could have been 1 divided by gamma by. So the R is there because of what you said. So the point that came up is actually an interesting observation. Imagine you have examples of imagine you have positive examples and negative examples. It seems like the margin is very, very large. Right? So there's a large gap. Let's see. Yeah. But imagine that we now have a camera looking at this and we zoom out. When we zoom out, both of these things come closer and maybe the positives look like this and the negatives look like this. And now, just by moving the camera, the margin seems to have become smaller. Right? How can the data set become more difficult to learn just because someone who is watching the data set moves farther away? The reason, and the way that is controlled for, is that R parameter. And I'm not going to draw the circle here, but R for this data set is going to be big. And R for this data set, in which case I can actually draw that circle, so let me do it. R for this data set will be small. Which means, in both cases, it doesn't matter whether you scale the data or not, the fact that the points are scaled by R will keep the learning rate fixed. Sorry, not the learning rate, the mistake bound fixed. Alright, so I'm going to we have 4 minutes, so I'm not going to start the proof, I'm just going to set it up and then we'll pick up from here again. Yes?
Why do we need R instead of, we can use just 0 because we can be separated by, if it's bigger than 0 or if it's
you mean why you need gamma?
Yes.
So if gamma becomes smaller, the data set becomes harder to train because imagine that your R is very, very large. Let's consider the case on top. If R is very large, instead of using this, I want to let me delete this whole thing. So case one is R is large and gamma is large, let's say. Case two, let's say R is large. And gamma is very small. R is large because the distance between the farthest points is really big. You need a big circle to put all of those things, but gamma is very small. the data set on top, this is, let's call this gamma 0 and this is gamma 1. Here R is large and R is small.
Wait,
R is the same, sorry, my bad. In both cases, oh good, so you are more awake than me. So in both cases, R is small. So gamma is large and gamma is small. You would agree that the first data set is easier than the second one.
So this has nothing to do with the mistake bounds.
Let's look at the R squared over gamma squared. Gamma 1 squared. R is the same, so we can just drop it. So let's consider 1 over gamma 1 squared versus 1 over gamma 0 squared. This quantity is going to be less than this quantity, because gamma is larger there. Which means the perceptron algorithm will make fewer mistakes on the data set on top than the data set at the bottom.
But the theorem is to prove the mistake bound, which has nothing to do with the complexity.
The mistake bound, oh, the game we are playing is we are still in the broader context is we are looking at mistake bound learning. Complexity of learning as the mistake bound. The learning, the so we are still talking about how do we define learning, right? For these 2 weeks, we are playing the game of learning is defined by the number of mistakes. And complexity of learning is actually is measured by how many mistakes that the learner make. So learning, the mistake bound is the complexity of learning. Alright, that was a very convenient question because you took me to the end of class. So I'm not going to start the proof. We'll start the next lecture with the proof, and you should start on the homework. At this point, I think even without the proof, you might be able to do some initial probes into the data set and start thinking about how you implement it.